So what do you say? Ready for that last push to program circulation pumps logic? First, we need to define the control strategy. Why do we have circulation pumps in the first place? To deliver heated water to the final consumer. How fast do we need to do that? Well, it's a function of how much heated energy is consumed. Of course, we don't have specific value of energy spent, but we have return water temperature value, which, if you think about it, is reversely proportional to consumed energy. We just need to compare this temperature to T2 value of the temperature graph and then adjust pump speed. Bigger the difference between T2 and return water temperature, the faster pumps need to run. Let's do some coding. Okay, program is already created. Temp graph function is called to calculate T2 value. This time we would need full version of PID controller with integral part. T2 goes to set point input, return water temperature goes to actual value input. Proportional and integral gain parameters go to inputs KP and TN respectively. Since we control relatively slow process with long response time, derivative gain could be omitted. Output Y range is 0 to 100%, and output Y itself goes directly into drive's speed set point. Typically, centrifugal pumps require a minimum speed to create enough centrifugal force to overcome the system's head and begin moving fluid effectively. We could have done that in drive settings, but I prefer to have more control over application, so compare speed set point to minimum speed value, run result through switch on delay timer, and then output of the timer connect to pumps switch function block, which we have developed before. Remember, we have two pumps and only one of them runs at the same time. Pump switch takes care of it. Create two local pump ready variables and two run pump variables and connect them to pump switch function block. Next, you need to check whether pump is ready to operate. It is considered to be ready when auto switch is turned on and there is no general or pump specific faults. And of course, you need to copy the same code for the second pump. Now, we actually have two ways to run a pump. Normal way through a VSD, or in case VSD has failed, through direct online start. To cover the first case, drag in run pump one variable, add VSD fault signal, combine both with AND operator, and invert the fault signal. Even though conductors 1, 2, and 3, 4 are electrically interlocked with one another, it is a good idea to introduce small delay to make sure two conductors are not enabled at the same time. Declare a timer in local variable section, and instead of specifying PT input on a diagram, put default value in the declaration. Add the timer to the diagram and connect digital output to enable conductor to queue output of the timer. Repeat the same for pump 2. Next, you combine two signals with OR to give run command to the VSD. With the same approach, implement DOL start of pumps 1 and 2. The only difference would be that the fault signal will not be inverted. Few words about fault tolerance of an application. Generally, if you detect some kind of fault, you will stop operation until fault is clear. But sometimes it's not really the cleverest way. For example, if return water temperature sensor fails, you have no feedback in your control loop. You can't operate. But instead of stopping heat delivery completely, you could switch system to some kind of safe fallback mode. What it would mean in case of pump control is to connect sensor fault variable to manual input, and then define fallback speed at the Y manual input. Which would mean that in case of sensor fault, pump would run with constant predefined speed. It could be not enough or too much depending on weather, but at least we would maintain certain level of temperature. It also doesn't make any sense to keep PID running if there is no pumps ready to operate. Therefore, connect inverted ready signal to the reset input of PID controller. Good, let's try to simulate what we've just developed. Set return water temp to 35 degrees, ambient temp to 1 degree, switch it to run. To unblock PID operation, set both pumps into auto mode, and we definitely see something is going on. PID output is rising because of integral part. Pump 1 is selected to run. There is no VSD fault, therefore respective contactor is closed and VSD itself is running as well. This example is really small and it's possible to have all related information in one page for debugging and commissioning. But imagine you have application with 2, 5, 10 times more variables. It's no longer that easy to keep track of everything without jumping like crazy from one tab to another. But Automation Builder has a solution to tackle this problem. Go to Application, Add Object, scroll down and find Visualization. Add object, give it some name, let's call it pumps control, and you have blank canvas in front of you. Let's start with something basic. In visualization toolbox, where all graphical elements are located, find subsection lamps and switches and drag lamp widget to the canvas. In the properties panel, change lamp's color to green, and then the most interesting part. Let's say we want this lamp to indicate pump 1 contactor state. Then we find property variable, click the button on the right, and you will see input assistant window, which we have seen many times already. Find the variable in the global mapping and confirm the selection by pressing enter. So how does it work? For that, you would need to go online and put PLC to run. Still, nothing has changed. That is because the pump is not running. Go back to the program and put both pumps to auto mode. You can see in the program that variable has changed. And yay, the same is visible in visualization tab. Let's add states of all contactors and organize them a bit. You can not only display the state of variables, but also control them. And since we use the simulator, we can treat digital inputs like normal variables. Find checkbox widget in the toolbox and drag it to canvas. Change the text to auto, make it smaller, and again in the properties panel, find variable field and specify a variable you want to control. Repeat it for pump 2. Go online and put PLC to run. Enable auto mode and hey, it works. Pump 1 is running. Let's try to switch to pump 2. Nice. Now add VS default simulation to check this switch over. And while we're still here, let's add VSD speed as well. Find text field object and drag it to canvas. Add some text to give a hint of what values are displayed, then find text variable property and link corresponding variable. Let's see how it works. Auto, okay, pumps run with VSD, simulate fault, it switches over to direct line, clear the fault, and it switches back to VSD operation. But speed field only shows static text. Go offline and let's try to fix the issue. It turns out that it's not enough to link a variable to a field. You need to use a placeholder inside the text. Different data types have their own placeholders. If you scroll down and find floating point number or real, it's the same thing, you would see that in order to display, let's say, 3 digits before comma, and 1 digit precision after comma, you would type percentage sign 3 dot 1 and then F. Let's put it to use. Enable pumps. Yeah. 100. Let's check in the program. It's 100 indeed. Okay, controlling digital input seems to be pretty easy. Let's see how we can control analog value, or analog input in particular. Bring in slider widget, slightly reshape it, attach it to return water temperature input, adjust scale start and scale end parameters. Those are the range within which we control the value. Now add scaled value of the temperature next to the slider so we have also numerical representation of the value. Let's check it online. Drag the slider. Good. Your value changes. Switch pumps to auto and by adjusting temperature, see how PID controller reacts with the speed value. Numerical value which changes on a screen is good, but we already have seen this with pulse generations. It's much easier to perceive information graphically. And you can easily do it inside visualization. In fact, the process is very similar to what we have done with the standalone trays. Before adding trays, add some more analog signals like ambient temperature, suction and discharge pressure. If we have pressure value, why not to add pump fault signals? T2 temperature will definitely be useful as well. And now comes the trace object. As I mentioned before, logic behind is pretty much the same as for standard trace object. You attach it to a task, you add a variable, maybe make a line a bit thicker, adjust display settings to make time interval fixed. Y-axis range is known, 0 to 100%. How often do we want to sample the signal? 5 times a second should be good enough. Okay, then okay again. Go online. Set return temperature somewhere here. Allow pumps to work. Wow, quite a jump. Play with temperature and watch how speed reacts to it. We've got to pump one fault because pressure values are zero. Therefore, after specified delay, fault is detected. Adjust discharge and suction pressure values to something more realistic. And now if you take and give back auto signal, fault will be cleared and pump will be ready again. Probably one more thing we should check is how controller behaves when we change gain values. Add KP variable field. If leave it as it is, the field will only display the value, but we want to change it as well. Therefore, go to input configuration and find on mouse click event. Click configure. On the left, you can see the list of available actions. Select right variable, move it to the right, then change input type to numpad. This way, pop-up numpad will be displayed. Do the same for TN variable as well. Now in online mode, let's check how PID controller reacts to the change of integral gain. Lower value increases the slope of the curve. Now, if you change it to 100, we have almost flat shelf on the graph. Very nice bonus, which comes with built-in visualization in Automation Builder, is ability to access it through a web browser. You might have already spotted this web visual item under Visualization Manager. Here you can adjust scaling options, your start page, and its size. To make the whole thing work, you need to go to Onboard Ethernet Interfaces and add Web Server under it. Now load the project to a PLC, and after that is done, go to Web Browser, type IP address of the PLC /webvisu.htm. Hit Enter, and it's absolutely the same interface as we've seen before in Automation Builder, with only difference that now we can't control inputs. And you can see how this could be beneficial for remote monitoring using even smartphone or tablet. Of course, this functionality cannot replace traditional HMI completely, but in some cases, it could very well be a solution. And that is all for today and for introduction into AC500 course overall. As I mentioned in the beginning, we'll not be touching advanced stuff, but at this point you have fully functional heating substation which is controlled by AC500 EcoCPU. Kudos on completing the course. Practice. Don't stop learning and keep automating with us. See you guys in the next one. Peace.